So, as Brian said, I'm one of the lead assessor for TMMi and the only one, I mean, I'm humbled to be the only one in North and South America. That's how we're just going to talk in detail about the technology client. They are based out of Austin, Round Rock, and how we enable them. It's a successful case study for Cognizant. Back in 2014, they called Cognizant. We'll get to the next few slides. This was the request from them. I mean, they said that we wanted to be TMMi level 3 and how you guys can help us out. So I'm just going to talk about what we did right from the scratch and how we enable them to succeed in their journey. So this whole presentation is about how we enable them. Before I get to the next slides, since I just talked about they're based in Austin, any guesses? Can you guess who the client is? No? Okay, maybe let's go to the next few slides and see. I'll still keep you guessing. This is the agenda. We're just going to talk about what was the background, how did they call us, what was their intent, what do they want to go for TMMi level 3. And we're going to talk about what is TMMi, what are the different stages that are adopted, what are the various maturity levels in TMMi journey. And we're going to talk about, we took a 5-phase approach for this particular client. And what are those 5 phases? We're going to talk in, I can't go in detail. I can even talk for half a day on this. It's such a detailed topic, but I'll make it quick. And again, it depends on the kind of questions and how soon you can grasp it. Or if you have more questions, probably I can just alter my pace accordingly. All right. So this might give more insight into who the client is. So the business unit of this particular technology client, they were focused on the storage, servers, and hardware. And the QA unit, the QA organization of this group is probably like 420-ish, including contractors. And they're based out of Austin, Texas. They had the satellite offices in Taiwan, and they have a major, one of the biggest offices in based out of Bangalore. Any guess now?
No.
Got it? All right, so Dell, they called Cognizant back in 2014. They wanted to improve the test effectiveness, and they're very much lacking when it comes to the test efficiency. And for commercial purposes, I think they are also into services, and they want to differentiate their QA services from their competitors. And so they felt, TMMi could enable them in this particular journey, and they called us. And PQC is nothing but process and quality consulting within Cognizant. So I'm part of this particular group. It's part of the larger group called CBC, Cognizant Business Consulting. We do a lot of test consulting for various clients. I've done a lot of assessments. We'll talk about it probably in next few slides. So this is the gist of it, why they wanted to go for it, and they call Cognizant. And I was the first person from Cognizant to get into Dell. So we had our own challenges. If you already don't have any presence in that particular client, it has its own challenges, both plus and minus. Okay. All right. So, how many of you know what is TMMi?
CMMI.
That's good. Anyone on TMMi? Okay. What is CMMi? Let's go to CMMi first. Okay. So, CMMi is a framework. It's again a maturity framework, which covers your entire software life cycle. Right from your requirements to the design to your code to the testing, even to the production. I mean, they have a service, CMMi for services, which talks about the managed service model on the production support as well. ITIL, ITSM, everything comes into play there. But there was limited focus was given to testing. CMMi just talks about, there are two process areas from CMMi, which probably validation is one and verification. Talks about, they touch upon testing, the aspects of testing. But the industry analysts, they felt a need to have their own model for testing. See, something similar to TMMi. They felt there is a need. We need something, a collection of best practices, which is completely 100% focused on testing practices, testing processes. That's how TMMi got evolved. And it has been run by TMMi Foundation. Where is TMMi? Any guess who owns TMMi? It's SEI, in collaboration with Carnegie Mellon University. Okay. So TMMi is 100% focused on the testing practices, whereas TMMi covers your entire software development life cycle. So feel free to ask me any questions. You can stop me. Or you can even hold on to your questions to the end. So TMMi, they copied the exact structure of TMMi. How many of you are familiar with TMMi? How their structure is? Okay, I see one hand. Two, three. Okay. All right, so. Okay. So they have five different levels of maturity. Again, TMMi copied exact structure. Everything, you have your goals, practices. We're going to see in a few slides. You can see the five levels of maturity. So Dell wanted to go for TMMi level 3, okay? But you can go up to level 5. Level 5 is more advanced. So your rating starts from level 2 onwards. You might be wondering, I mean, there is no process area in level 1, okay? So whether you have a process or not, you're already, whether you follow a process or not, you're already at level 1. So the actual rating starts from level 2 onwards. Okay, so Dell wanted to go for level 3. So in that case, this is a staged approach, whereas TMMi has staged and continuous. It's a little different. I mean, it's a lengthy topic. So something, what is staged? If you want to go for level 3, level 2 also has to be fulfilled. For example, if you want to go for level 4, 2, 3, and 4 has to be fulfilled. Okay, so what are these? These are the process areas. So for Dell, since their goal was to go for level 3, level 2 had 5 process areas and level 3 had 5 process areas. So as a whole, they had to fulfill all the 10 process areas, including level 2 and 3, which is managed and defined. So level 2 had, start from your test policy. Whether you have a policy in place, I don't know, how many organizations has a test policy? Okay, I see some hands, okay. And obviously test planning, if you have project planning, there has to be some focus on test planning. It's similar to your project monitoring and control. TMMi also has the same process area. So these are the process areas, but under these process areas, you have goals. So you have process areas, I'll call it PA. So under these process areas, you have goals. So we saw we have they had to fulfill the 10 process areas. And under these 10, each and every process area in turn had a lot of goals. And again, each and every goal in turn had practices. And again, practices are called, you have specific practice and generic practice. So when we do a rating assessment, we start from the bottom up, which probably, once you see the next few slides, you will have a better understanding of it. I'll go to the rating slide and again, I'll come back to this. So just take into consideration, it's always a bottom up approach. Okay, so we start from the practice. For example, we saw test planning. In planning, I mean, it's a process area. A goal related to estimation is there. And under the estimation, you need to estimate for the testing effort. How many of you do estimates for your effort spent on testing? We all plan for it. And there are organizations, they don't have it. So So that is one of the practices. Okay, it gets rolled up to the goal level, then practice, process area, and then maturity level. Okay. So Dell, we took this five-phased approach. We started with a informal assessment. How many of you are familiar with assessments? Or have you been part of any assessments, test assessments, or it could be non-QA assessment as well? How many of you have done assessments or been part of the assessment?
Like self-assessment? Or having a formal body come in and assess?
It could be formal or informal. Yeah, I see a few hands. Okay, that's good to know. Okay, so we started with an informal assessment. So after the informal assessment, typically what is the output of the assessment?
Rating.
Rating, okay. So the rating leads to what? What are the next steps from the rating? I'm sure if you are fulfilling the rating, then it's fine. If the rating is not fulfilled, what are the next steps?
Action items.
So those action items somehow has to be fixed. So that was part of the implementation phase. Going to see in detail. And one of the practice talks about adherence. So that's more focused on the audits. So that's why we had a phase called audits, ongoing audits. Okay. One of the practice talks about objectively evaluate the adherence of all the practices that you define. Okay. And there are various ways that you can measure it, but one of the easiest ways, have an audit team do it. And then we have a readiness, it's kind of a quality check before they went for the formal assessment. And then the last phase is the formal assessment and they got the certification. Okay. So when we did the informal assessment, they thought, okay, they are in a good shape. I mean, okay, you guys can do an assessment and there could be some few gaps. Maybe we can fix it in a month or two, and we can also plan for the formal assessment in the next 3 months. So that was the ask. When we did the informal assessment against the level 2 and level 3 process areas, okay, we found a lot of gaps. They can't do it in the next 3 months. So we gave a roadmap for more than 12 months based on the level of gap that we found. We also gave a recommendation on how they can fix those gaps. So that was part of the informal assessment. So typically, how long the assessment can take place? Any guess?
6 months.
that's a long time. Okay. We're just going to see, are they doing things right? Okay. And again, since the focus was, the scope is level 3, so we had 10 process areas as part of the scope. So we did a 4-week assessment, and again, it could vary. I mean, we have clients who want us to level 5 assessment, so it varies from 4 to 6 weeks, and again, it depends on the kind of the business units that they want to cover. And for Dell, it was pretty simple. I mean, they had those 3 business units, Dell storage, server, and hardware. There are organizations where they want us to cover their entire IT. So we have done 3-month assessments as well. Okay. So for Dell, we just did a 4-week assessment. And again, this is going to be not only for TMMI, for any assessment, it's still going to be the same. Even for the formal assessment, the process is still the same. You plan for it. And again, how do you do the assessment? We have to talk to the various stakeholders, right? You have to identify who the stakeholders are. You have to review their processes. Maybe there could be some process at the global business unit level. What are those processes? Are they fulfilling the criteria? You need to talk to identify some sample projects that can represent these 3 business units. Again, I mean, they might be having hundreds of projects and we can't do the assessment. We can't talk to all the teams. So we do a sampling, making sure all their life cycles are covered. Okay, all the geographical units are getting covered. So likewise, we took 10 projects into consideration. And all kind of projects, different samples of projects. We need definitely projects from waterfall. We need the projects from agile. So again, we need projects covering all the geographical regions as well. There could be projects which is purely based out of Bangalore. There could be projects purely based out of US. So we want to cover all the geographies as well, and even all kind of complexities. At least one project which is business critical. So taking into consideration all these guidelines, we had almost 10 projects that we had as part of this 4-week assessment. So we came up with an assessment plan. Who all the stakeholders we have to conduct, we'll have to talk to all the stakeholders for those 10 projects. Okay. And again, survey is an optional thing, which we didn't do it. Document review. So for all those 10 projects, we went through all the documents, the test plan, how are they estimating their efforts for testing. And again, based on the scope, I mean, for all those 10 process areas, we did the document review. And there are certain standards which are available at the business unit level, like, for example, the test estimation methodology. Okay. And there could be like test strategy at an org level. Okay. So again, we went through all those reviews of those processes that they already had. And the next thing is interviews. For all those 10 projects, we just talked to all the stakeholders. So as an outcome, we identify a lot of strengths. There are some good points, good things that they are doing, good practices. There are a lot of things that they need to improve on. So we came with a current state report. So this is typically for any assessment, they call it findings report or current state report. It will have all the strengths and the opportunities for improvement. Okay, basically the gaps. You have all the gaps here. And when they looked into the report, they agreed, I mean, these are truly their gaps. And in order to fix those gaps, we came up with a recommendation roadmap and the implementation plan. So we gave a plan for roadmap for almost, it was like more than 12 months. So earlier they thought, I mean, they can just do it in a couple of months. So, but the roadmap we gave was for more than 12 months, and they did agree. Okay. So when I said stakeholders, can you guess who all could be the stakeholders? So for the 10 projects, I mean, assume that you are an assessor. Whom do you like to talk to? Yeah, so everyone from the testing team, right? You will have test analysts or the test engineers, then managers. Yeah.
What's environment team?
Okay, so there's something called test environment. They had a lab, so the lab team was taking care of their entire test environments. Whether the environment is up and running, whether the availability is 100% or not, whether the environments have been monitored. So we have one process area for test environments. Just to fulfill that, we had to talk to the test environment as well.
DevOps,
yeah. So not just the testing folks. We, since testing has interfacing with, they again, with a lot of other people, they have like upstream as well as downstream interfacing. We have to talk to the business analysts, the BAs, product owners, dev. Again, dev, I mean, their inputs are going to be very critical. The project managers, and also to the production support team. I mean, what if there is a lot of defect leakage into the production? Okay, so we have to analyze the production defects as well. There will be a QC admin in some cases. Yeah, go ahead.
So you said that you did this for Agile and Waterfall?
Yes, for both.
Did you include product owners?
Yes, product owners too. Yeah. And again, TMMI, let me make it more clear. TMMI is for, it doesn't pertain to any one particular life cycle or methodology. I mean, whether you have waterfall, whether you have agile, or any methodology that you follow, TMMI is going to be applicable for all. And it's applicable for any industry, whether it is life science, communication, or healthcare, or or it's a tech industry. TMMI is going to be applicable for all industries. All right?
I was just going to say, reminding how long this whole process took of assessment, you know, interviews and the
It's 4 weeks.
4 weeks.
4 weeks, yeah.
And how many people? From Cognizant.
From Cognizant. We had two from offshore, and we had four from on-site. So basically six.
During the assessment process, were you trusting that they wouldn't change the process during the 4 weeks you were assessing them?
Yeah, they didn't change anything.
I know with all the teams like that, the times when I called out for a gap that, you know, oh, I should have a meeting right now, because it's really working. So that might interfere with the assessment.
No, we didn't encounter such scenario. But typically, I mean, we have not seen that. Okay, so it's the rating. I mean, we told clearly that they are not at level 3. Why? Because of the rating guidelines. We followed the guidelines which TMMi already has. It's called TAMAR, TMMi Assessment Method Application Requirements. Again, when we do the rating, there are 10 projects that we assessed. For all those 10 projects, we give a rating at the practice level. Okay, we'll say whether this is fully achieved, partially achieved, or it could be not achieved. And if they are fully achieved, they'll have multiple practices. Again, we'll do this for project 1, project 2, project 3, project up to project 10. If all the 10 projects are fully achieved, then we'll say the goal is also fully achieved. Okay? And if the goals, and again, there are multiple goals, if all the goals are fully achieved, then we'll say the process area itself is fully achieved. Again, level 2 has 5 process areas, then level 3 has 5 process areas. So if all these 10 are fully achieved, then we'll say, okay, you are level 2 and level 3. Got it? If one of the practices partially or not achieved or largely achieved, it's going to be a challenge. So when we do the roll-up, you can see an example here. One is fully achieved, the other one is largely achieved. So when you kind of do a roll-up, you always take what is the least of all. Okay, not an average. This is typically, I mean, as per the guidelines, we just take one is at the first rating and the other one is fourth rating. Obviously, you are going to end up in fourth rating. Okay. Maybe this slide can give you. So when do you say it's fully achieved? If the compliance is almost 85 to 100%, okay, there are no major weakness. There are a lot of strengths. For example, it could be your test planning. Okay, when you're doing that for that particular practice, whether you have a process in place, and I guess for all the 10 projects, if you feel there are no major weakness and you feel that as a strength, so you give it as fully achieved. If you find some minor weakness, maybe for one project, even though they have a process defined at org level, I think for one particular case, I mean, they are not doing it effectively. And if the weakness is minor, again, you can call it as largely achieved. It's 50 to 80%, 85. So partially, again, if it is between 15 and 50, we have a template. So the moment you, for all the 10 projects, it's pretty easy to do it. I mean, for lack of time, I'm not going into all the other details. So we have a ready-made template which is approved by TMMi Foundation. And for all the 10 projects, it's pretty simple. You can always drag, just select it, not achieved, fully achieved. So it automatically does the calculation and gives you the rating. And there could be a case where the project is in the initial phase, okay? So in those kind of scenarios, test planning could be applicable, but they haven't done any test execution. So if anything, any practice or any process area related to your defects, you may not see any defects because they are still in the initial phase, right? So when you can't rate those practices, right? When it comes to defects, execution hasn't happened. So we just make it like not applicable. Sorry, not rated. Not applicable is different. Okay. So we came up with, based on the gaps, we told, okay, these are the areas that you need to focus on. And again, there are like 11 different focus areas that we had. Maybe I'm just giving a sample here. So these are the areas that we identified. They didn't have an audit team in place. They didn't have a lot of process, test process assets. And again, test planning was, it seems to be pretty weak there. Test design techniques, boundary value analysis. I don't know if how many of you can relate equivalence partitioning. Estimation was a big gap. And again, they had waterfall, they had agile. So we had to come up with a estimation technique for both methodologies. Traceability. I have done a lot of assessments so far, like almost more than 45. Whenever I do, I always find this gap very consistent. Traceability is always a big gap for any organization. And again, NFT, non-functional testing. It includes stress, performance, load, longevity, even your security. Everything's part of the non-functional testing. Risk, then review. There is a process area related to review. So reviews were not happening well. And there is a focus process area on training. Okay. What if there are a lot of areas related to test training. So we rolled out role skill matrix. I don't know how many of you are familiar with role skill matrix. For example, that when it comes to the estimation, so this particular role, for example, test analyst, when it comes to estimation, he doesn't have to be an expert in it. He just needs to know the basic of what an estimation is, right? But whereas a test manager, he needs to be an expert in estimation. But when it comes to the analysis, root cause analysis of defects, things like that, you don't expect a test manager to be an expert in all those things. Maybe a test design technique, right? Boundary value analysis. Managers are not supposed to be an expert in those areas. So we had something called role skill matrix for these kind of roles, okay? For these areas, these roles have to operate at this level, okay? If you see a gap, then I think they need to go for some training. Test environment, I think we just touched upon it. Let's go back to the previous slide. So the lot of processes could be missing in most of the organizations when you do an assessment. So what we do is like process definition is going to be the first phase as part of the implementation. We define all the missing processes, guidelines, checklists, templates, whatever it is. And there could be cases they already might be having it. For example, test strategy could be one of the process. They already have it, but it's not very detailed. Okay, so you might have to refine their existing process. That's again part of the process standardization itself. So that's the first step as part of implementation. Okay, and once the process is defined. Okay, so any experience with process definition from any of you? Okay, good. So what typically happens when you define a process? After the process is defined, do you directly roll it out to all the projects?
A lot of reviews,
right. And after the reviews, if you feel the process is ready, how do you roll it out?
It's better to roll out in phase, at least bring it out so you don't overwhelm the system because the people get too frustrated with it.
Mm-hmm.
You need to do a lot of training.
Exactly. So training is going to be a key thing because the process is new. So you have to make sure everyone is trained on it. So training it's the next key phase within the implementation. And after the team is trained, again, not in all the cases we just roll it out directly to the at the org level. What we try to do is we just try to take some sample projects and do a piloting. We just pilot, and again, based on the current phase of the project, we'll identify okay, project A might be a good candidate for this particular, maybe for test estimation. Assume test estimation was a gap and we defined a process for test estimation. We have something called test case points. So that was one of the process that we defined for Dell. Again, when I want to do a pilot, I can't do a pilot where for a close project or a project which is about to be close in the next few weeks. I want to do it for a project which is just in the initial stage where they are going to do an estimate. Okay, so we identified projects accordingly and did a pilot. So that's what you see here, pilot. And based on the outcomes of the pilot, in some cases, whatever you define may not make sense. You might have to again make some changes based on the outcomes of the pilot. So that's why after pilot, you directly, you can't go, you can't roll it out to the entire organization. You have to wait for the results of your pilot. So based on the outcomes, there are places where we again have to modify the defined process because the pilot didn't work out well. So we have to fine tune some of the areas in some of the practices in those processes. Okay. Once it was successful, we were able to successfully roll it out to the entire organization. Okay. So any questions before move to the next one? We just saw this. Audits. So again, as I told you, one of the practice was objectively evaluate adherence to all the defined processes. We have defined a lot of processes now. How do you make sure that not just the 10 projects, but the entire organization is following well, following all the practices? So we formed something called audit champions. And again, the audit champions, they'll be kind of overseeing the effectiveness of the defined processes across the three different geographical units. So they again internally had some audit leads, for one for NA, one for the projects executed out of India, one for Taiwan. And they came up with an audit plan. Okay, so we have so many projects at such and such duration, we are going to audit it. And again, what typically happens after the audit? There could be some non-compliances. How are they going to fix it? So you might have to again follow up after 2 weeks or 4 weeks based on the non-compliances. So still have 10 more minutes. Okay. So again, we made sure audits are part of their ongoing process. Okay. So once the audits were done, we directly didn't want Dell to go for a formal certification. How many of you had experiences going for visa interviews for different countries? Yeah, there are a few. Okay. So we typically kind of do a mock-up, right? Maybe you go through the internet and see, okay, what kind of questions they will be asking. So that's what we typically did. We had something called readiness, a period of 4 weeks. We made sure, we kind of did a mock-up assessment for the entire organization. What kind of questions typically will be asked, how you need to respond, how not to respond during the formal assessment. So those were part of the readiness phase that we did for Dell. And again, I again want to reiterate, there's something, it's a very major change, bigger quality transformation. So I didn't touch upon the OCM part of it, organizational change management. We defined something called TWG, Technical Working Group Committee. Even from within Dell, we identified 10 people across three different geographical regions who will be part of this particular committee. And again, as from Cognizant, we had a limited people who had to be placed on to this implementation. So I can't be doing and I can't be training the entire 400 plus organization, right? And again, even for piloting, okay, I have 5 more minutes. So even for piloting, I can't do the piloting for all the hundreds of projects that they have. So we formed technical working group committee. So they were kind of, I would say, like change agents, enabling all the changes that we did, helping me in this whole journey. Helping me, I mean, in the sense, cognizant of this whole journey. So we trained them, and they in turn trained the other team leads. So that's how we did the whole implementation. So they worked very collaboratively with all of us. And formal assessment, it was a 6-week period. We did the assessment for 6 weeks. Again, as we saw, we had the assessment plan in place. But the rest, it's pretty much similar. We conducted the interviews, document analysis. But for formal assessment, one major requirement from TMMI is you need to definitely have a lead assessor and an assessor. So that's why, I mean, I during the course of journey, I myself became a lead assessor. And that's why, like, I mean, there was none in entire US, North America. So I myself became a lead assessor. And we had one from India who was an assessor. So that's a minimum criteria. You need to have one assessor and one lead assessor for any formal assessments. Okay. And again, we did check with TMMi Foundation if there is any gap, if there's any conflict, because I was involved in the process definition, process implementation, and now I'm going to do a formal assessment and certify them. There is absolutely no conflict of interest. So I was part of the formal assessment team, and they successfully passed through all the criterias. And in the final assessment report, we made it clear that they are level 3 certified. Okay. And once they are certified, we'll have to submit all these requirements. There's something called DSR, a detailed explanation, a detailed submission that has to be done to the TMMi Foundation. Again, a lead assessor has to do this. So I was submitting all these informations to TMMi Foundation. And they sent a formal certification to Dell, to the concerned executive committee of Dell. So if, again, I think I have a couple of more minutes. So there's a lot of references. Again, as I told you, I need at least half a day to go through in detail. You can go to the PNSQC site and you can see all these links. More than these, I would request you to go to tmmi.org and find more details about how assessments are being conducted, how it is going to benefit your organization. So overall, you can see a sea change in your quality transformation, scaling up your maturity to a greater extent. Okay. Again, if you or if your organization wants to go for TMMi, or I mean, some organizations, they don't want to go for a formal certification. They just want to see where they are. So I'm very much, I'll be glad to help you out. Any questions?
Lighter weight assessment
model. This sounds like a pretty big investment, the initial assessment, the 6 weeks, 6 people, mm-hmm. 4 weeks. I mean, I did the math on that. That's a big investment. And then another 6 weeks on the end to do the assessment. But do you have a more lightweight model that you recommend? Yeah, so Cognizant has two frameworks that we typically adopt. One is TMMi, and the other is, we call it Cognizant Assessment Framework. So it's more customized. It's more lightweight. So we can, again, I mean, sometimes, based on the needs of the client, we tell them TMMi is not suitable for you, we can go for Cognizant Framework.
I'm looking more for self-assessment. Mm-hmm. Is there another good model out there? You're looking at, like, the Agile maturity model,
so looking to go more Agile. Yeah, but again, TMMi, I mean, doesn't mandate you to be just focused only on Agile. I mean, it tells you what to do, but not how to do. How to do it depends on the organization. Okay, so again, if you go to tmmi.org, you have a framework model. It's a PDF. It's available to everyone. It's
sure,
open.
But it's kind of heavy. So I was just wondering if there are other good lighter weight models for assessment.
So typically, I mean, based on what is available in the framework, you can kind of say, you know, what are the practices? If you're going for level two, there are like certain set of practices which has to be fulfilled. So again, I mean, since you don't want any of the external party to get involved, you might have to make sure whether all the practices are getting fulfilled. I mean, you might have to, again, come up with a, based on the practices, specific and generic practice, you might have to create your own model. That's the only thing. Okay. Any other questions? Yeah.
Have you done any assessments at medical companies and where do they typically fall? Because we have some sort of structure and processes that we have to follow up to the FDA. Have you guys had any experience with that device?
There was one requirement we got from life science, I think the life science client based out of LA. But unfortunately, I mean, I was not able to fulfill their needs. So yes, we do get requirements and the model is going to be similar for whether it's a healthcare life science client or a communication client. It's still going to be the same, but unfortunately, I did not get a chance to work on the life science client.
I think what we're going to do is jump in here and make sure we wrap up the session because lunch is going to start in about 5 minutes. And so it's walk through, it's meet the speakers as well. So make sure that you guys get a chance to participate in the tables out there. It's really great networking. Again, thanks, Suresh. This is outstanding. Big round of applause. Really good stuff. Remember.